Yeah, let me complete. Hello everyone, good afternoon. Welcome to agricultureinformation.com webinar. Today we are going to interact with Mr. Amol on organic certification services. And the format of this webinar will be as follows. I will mute everyone in the audience except Mr. Amol. Mr. Amol will make his presentation. After we listen to him, we can ask him our questions. And you can ask your questions by typing your questions in the chat box. Or you can also email me at ed@agricultureinformation.com. I repeat, ed@agricultureinformation.com. And I'll ask the same questions to Mr. Amol. And if you have time, I may unmute one or two members in the audience so that you can directly talk to Mr. Amol. Yeah, Mr. Amol, now you can start.
Okay, thank you. Okay. I'm Amol Nirban. Let me introduce myself. I'm working with an organization called EcoCert. And EcoCert is an organic certification body. Well, I'm basically from agriculture background. I did my agriculture from Maharashtra. I studied in Maharashtra and Karnataka. I did PhD in agriculture, and since past 6 years, I'm working in EcoCert as at different capacities. I joined as inspector, then I was certification officer too, and then now I look after business development activities. As for EcoCert, the organization where I work, let me brief you. In very few words, it was established in France in 1991, and it is basically a global certification company, organic certification company. It was started in 1991, and then as of today, we have like 23 offices in the entire world, which take care of organic certification requirements in different parts of the world. In India, EcoCert was started in 2002. And since past almost 11 years, we are working in India, looking after the certification requirements for organic agriculture, food, cosmetics, textile in entire India, as well as the neighboring country, the South Asian country. Usually there is always a question: why one needs organic certification? Why farmer or processor or trader, they need organic certification? It's because of the two major reasons. Because there should be some standardization of the definition of organic. So there are always standards. Because everyone comes up with his own ideas of what could be organic. That happened in the past. And then different countries launched their own organic regulation. And that is why today we have different a uniform standard for each country. So need of certification arises, that has led to this development. And then today, there is something called common, we have a common definition for organic agriculture, and we can say that this particular produce is organically certified as per Indian regulation or as per EU regulation. Then second thing is, why we need certification is because we have to earn consumer confidence, because consumer is always distantly placed, he's not really has an access to an organic farmer's farm, every moment. So there should be a third party certification body which impartially goes and inspects and decides whether this produce is allowed to be called as organic or not. Then when we talk about organic certification, there are different standards, which we as per against which we can inspect a particular facility, be it a farm or processing unit or a trading activity. The major standards for which the Indian farmers, they go for our Indian regulation firstly, then there is European regulation, there is US regulation, NOP, and then there is Japanese regulation. These are the major regulation, major standards, major countries, for which they have their country specific standards, as per which Indian farmers usually try to get certified, against these standards. Now, it will be interesting to know what are the different activities or business sectors where we can certify organic products. So, as I have been talking, it is organic agriculture first, but it is not confined to only organic farming, because many people consider organic can be certified, only food products can be certified, but it's not like that. There are other business sectors as well. For example, besides agriculture, there is wild harvested, there are wild harvested commodities. Many people harvest wild products, non-timber forest produce, and they can be certified, like honey, for example, or mushroom. They can be certified. The wild harvest forest. Then there is organic input, the fertilizers, pesticides. They can be certified. You know, because many times farmers find it difficult to decide which organic biofertilizer has to be put in the agriculture. In that case, they should be going for certified input. Then there are textile products, there are cosmetic products which can be certified as per organic. The natural, you know, textile products coming from natural fibers, they can be certified as per organic standards. And then there are different specific standards for these business sectors. As far as cosmetics products, EcoCert has its own private standard, and rather EcoCert was the first organization which brought out this very standard for organic cosmetic certification, natural and cosmetics, herbal cosmetic certification. There is fair trade certification as well, and that is something extra to organic. And let me also present here a little bit about fair trade, because the today's topic also covers fair trade certification as well. So far we spoke about organic certification, and now let me brief you about fair trade. Fair trade is an kind of organized social movement, you know, that helps to that really helps the producers in developing countries, underdeveloped countries, to make better trading conditions and promote sustainability. It is basically about giving fair price to the exporter. It is about giving fair price to the producer and wage workers in, because usually in international trade it is the workers, wage workers and small producers, they are always ignored. They don't get fair price. They don't get better trading conditions. So aim of fair trade is to offer them this particular environment. As the name suggests, it is fair trade, you know, it's a trade which is fair. And it focuses in particular, you know, the major commodities which get exported as fair trade from our country are handicrafts, coffee, cocoa, sugar, tea, bananas, honey, cotton, and then fresh fruits, etc. If we really go into the definition, it's more clear. Fair trade is a trading partnership which is based on dialogue, you know, which is something missing in the conventional supply chain. Dialogue, transparency, and respect that seeks greater equity in international trade. It's about giving equitable share to everyone in the supply chain. Then, and it is expected to be contributing to the development of sustainable development of the poor farmers and wage workers. The basic principles are basically borrowed from international labor organization, ILO convention. So it's about non-discrimination and non-use of vulnerable workers. Then there should not the forced labor or child labor situations are not allowed. There should be fair working conditions. For example, there should be proper work hours. There should be respect to the national legislation as well. For example, in our case, the Factory Act is something which symbolizes the fair working condition. So there should be a respect to national legislation as well. There should be a proper safe workplace. Then workers should be given minimum wages. Workers should be given minimum wages, some social benefits, etc. You know, these are the areas which always remain ignored, and in fact, this is something, you know, which is being, the information is, the emphasis is laid more on these aspects. It is very simple to understand. For example, let me give you an example. A family in Europe, for example, somewhere in, or in any developed country, if they are buying organic bananas from India, at some point of time, they also get concerned about whether this organic, okay, I'm eating banana which is organic, it is not spoiling my health. But then I also wish to know whether the hands of the workers who were engaged, who were engaged in production of this banana, are they getting minimum fair price? Are their children going to school, or they have to work in the field? You know, these are the social concerns, environmental concerns that really led to the development of fair trade as a concept. And today we have fair trade certification. EcoCert has brought its own fair trade standard, but then there is Ecoset is a new player in the market. Recent player, the pioneers were the fair trade labeling organization, the FLO, and today we have IMO as well, another certification body who has got their own standards. In case of Ecoset, it is little bit different because it mandates organic and fair trade certification, you know, together. Any product can be certified as fair trade unless only then when it is also certified as organic. So having said about organic certification and fair trade certification, let me just take you through the stages of getting certified. Different stages. Steps of getting certification. So when a farmer or any operator, any processor, trader, they have to decide if they get certified, they have to decide according to which standard they want to get their project or product certified. Then operator has to fill the application form and submit to the certification body. Based upon that, certification body gives a quotation, and once that particular payment according to, you know, that particular quotation is agreed and paid, the proper inspection is arranged. And inspector actually visits the farmer's field or processing unit, whatever that facility is, and then he checks as per standards or if the organic practices are being conducted or not. And that's how after finishing the inspection, inspector submits the report, and then a farmer gets something called audit conclusion. He gets a document before certificate which informs the farmer or the producer or processor that okay, these are the missing areas, you have to comply to this within this particular time limit. And then we issue a proper certificate, or sometimes certification body decides not to issue certificate because perhaps there could be severe non-compliance. So this is all about certification procedure. And if we go into the cost part, the cost is always a concern for any producer or processor, but thanks to the market situation, the costs are very approximate, very optimized. And for example, a farmer up to 5 acres, he can get certified his land in like 8,000 rupees. And if it is a group certification program, it is always very cheaper in case of group certification. So if there is a group of 500 farmers, the cost would always come up to like 500 rupees or even 200 rupees per person, the annual cost. And it is really a very interesting deal because they together can bear the cost. Sometimes farmers don't have to even bear the charges, you know, when there is some processor or trader who is involved in the process. Sometimes there is a contract farming project and a processor themselves bear the cost of certification. So it all depends upon a proper response from the overseas market, proper demand, and then organic certification is really an interesting thing that can happen with the farmers in India, organic business and organic certification. People are always interested in validity of the certification too. So whenever we certify any project for any standard, validity is usually for 12 months. It's an annual thing, annual certification. And people ask why annual and why not in 3 years or something, but the very obvious reason is this is season-based activity. So every year you plant wheat or you plant bananas, and you know you get a new yield every year. So every year there is certain package of practices you follow. So that has to be inspected, and you know, given a guarantee should be given to the consumer that yes, on a continuous basis, I'm getting my production is inspected and certified. So I think I'm done with the basic presentation of the topic. Maybe we can invite.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Amol. Audience, you can start your questions. Lokesh has one question. What services are provided under organic certification services?
What services are provided under organic certification?
Yeah.
So services means the standards or Okay, let me repeat because I just explained this. So we basically can certify farming, wild harvesting part, then wild collection also, then processing of that. You know, it is like always entire supply chain approach. So processing of the farm based product, then trading activity also, then we also can certify cosmetic products, herbal cosmetics, natural of natural origin, textile products. So all these products can be certified as per different standards. So there are always different standards. For example, in case of agriculture, there is Indian regulation, there is US regulation, there is Japanese regulation, there are Korean standards as well, there are Brazilian, there are US and Canadian. So every country has got their own customs for organic standards, and they come up with their own regulation. So depending upon where your buyer is, you have to apply and, you know, get certified your activity as per those particular standards. But overall, the regulations don't really differ from each other. The basic principle always remains the same. You know, there are minor deviations. There is
okay.
Another,
Steve is asking.
Reply to Lokesh's question.
Okay.
Yeah, the cost of certification.
Yeah.
The cost, yes. Can Steve, I can give a, I just gave a brief idea that for group certification, for example, a group certification of 500 farmers, it is like 75,000 rupees. You know, it's an annual cost for certification. For example, if you have Mr. Steve, if you have some specific business segment, like for example processing unit or farming or individual farm, maybe you can ask and then maybe I can give a very specific answer. Because for individual, as long as individual farm is concerned, it is like 8,500 rupees, you know. Not orange in 200 acres. If it is one particular big farm of orange cultivation, orange plantation, then it depends upon, again, you know, the standard NPOP. But imagine if we go as per Indian regulation, that for Indian regulation NPOP, the 200 acre farm might, you know, the costing could be around, it could be around 30-40,000 rupees. You know, it depends. Again, it has to be at one place. So this is the annual charge, one time charge. You have to pay just one thing a year, and that is how it is charged. If we include another standard, yes, it's 30,000 annual, approximately.
Okay.
You know.
Rest of the audience, please ask your questions. Mr. Lokesh?
I think he is offline.
I received a few questions via email.
I can see another question from Mr. Steve. Processing 5 acres individual farm, you know. And let me again give you one another information. That crop is not really which matters, you know. That doesn't decide the cost of certification. So it is always the certification for the land. And for example, for this 5 acre farm, it could be 8,500 as per Indian regulation. The annual cost. There is another question. Is it from Rajni?
Yeah, I have asked you. I received an email. Do you have any time to reject the certification for any product? If yes, what are the parameters on the basis of which you take this decision?
Okay. The certification usually, you know, there are two times when the certification can be denied or rejected. One, during inspection, when the actual inspection is happening, if there is some severe non-compliance, imagine farmer actually was found using some non-compliant or non-conform material, some pesticide, you know, or if there is something beyond, you know, it could be a lack of every documentation. If the certification officer finds serious non-compliance, that time we can decide the denial, you know, we deny to certify that time. Then after having certified during that particular 1 year, because as I told, the validity is for entire 1 year. During the year, if we find that maybe we could do some surveillance inspection as well, because that is mandatory. So out of 500 operators with whom we are doing, you know, whom we are granting certification, maybe we can do surveillance of 5%, and that is always unannounced. So if during the surveillance we find something non-compliant severe activity, we might reject or we may withdraw that certification. So it might happen like that, you know. So and the parameter is always the regulation.
Okay. What is the cost per acre for certification?
I think it's a previous concern about the cost. Cost per acre is not really, you know, there is nothing. We can't really decide like that, you know, the per acre cost or something. It is always based upon mandate, you know. For example, we have how much time an inspector has to spend. So quotation is based upon that. So 0 to 5 acre, the cost is uniform. For example, for 1 acre also it is 8,500, and for 5 acre also it is 8,500.
Okay.
Okay.
Another question is, there are so many certification these days available, like series of ISO 9000 and ISO 14000 certification. In two sense, how to identify these, which certifications are important?
Okay. Yeah, it's a very good question. There are lot many certifications in the market, but we need to know because the certifications what they mentioned are system certification. They are basically system certification. For example, ISO 9000 can never be granted to any product. You know, it is always an organizational quality assurance system. So it depends, you know, certification should help you in the market. Hello.
Okay.
I'm not finished. You can hear me, right?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. So certification is always, you know, it has to help you in the market. If there is no demand for organic certification, then better not go for that. But if there is demand, you know, and from which country? For example, if I am growing mangoes in my field, you know, then for me it is very easy to decide which certification I should go for. I am a mango grower, and someday I am in touch with exporters. I am exporting to mangoes, for example, Alfonso mangoes to different parts of the world. And someday my buyer in Japan, he tells me that, okay, can you get me organic mangoes? So naturally I have to go for Japanese organic regulation. So this is how we decide, you know, this is how, and we always make guide you that which certification you might require. Maybe you can approach not really only us, but any other certification body as well for your inquiry.
Okay. And for food certification, are there any new clause added, as we see in everyday news? So many people losing their lives due to unhealthy food.
Yeah.
Mr. Amol, can you share your email address? Mr. Steve wants it.
Can I write here?
Yeah.
For food certification, are there any new clause added? I have seen every day so many people losing their lives due to unemployment. Yeah, that's true. You know, but now there is something called when it comes to food, the danger could be because of two things: because of the adulteration, and because of the unhealthy way of growing, that is conventional agriculture. If you are in case of what happened, for example, the very case of Bihar, the very food, the very grocery item, they were kept close to some insecticide. So you know, though they were not, I don't know where, whether they were grown organically or in a conventional farm, but the very food, the grocery item that came in contact with the insecticide. So it's always very important that during every entire supply chain, we should identify the critical control points. You know, there is a concept called HACCP. So HACCP certification is something which takes care of critical control points in order to avoid contamination, in order to avoid poisoning, you know, or mixing of the product with unhealthy thing. Imagine everything is done well. For example, there is organic rice which is grown organically, and then there is no contamination during the cultivation, harvesting, everything. But imagine the storage place. The storage place where it is kept, if we have some pest control measure,
Mr. Amol, you are there? We are unable to hear you.
Can anyone hear me? Hello?
Yeah, now we are able to hear.
Okay. Is there a yes? Another question? Is there another question?
Yeah, one second. Mr. Steve wanted your contact details.
I just gave.
Mr. Steve, you can email him your questions and your requirement.
Yes.
And which are the certifications identified by Government of India?
Certification standards, okay, or certification agencies. I don't know. Is it about agencies or if it, you know, if we are talking about organic certification, then Indian regulation is NPOP regulation. Yes, there is another question from Mr. Steve. We need certification for domestic market. Yes, we need. There is Indian regulation NPOP, that is for national. Program for Organic Production, NPOP, and that is from the Ministry of Commerce and Agriculture. So we certainly need organic certification if we are to sell in domestic market. NPOP, that is the regulation, and we can get the PDF copy on the website of APEDA. Maybe I can write here apeda.gov.in. So this is the link where you can get the basic information about NPOP.
Okay.
Organic agriculture. No, EcoCert is not really for exports. There is a question again. Is EcoCert only for exports? EcoCert is for domestic certification as well. It is a French, originally French certification body, but in the past 10 years, we are accredited by Indian government for working in India, and so we certify as for domestic regulation as well as foreign regulation.
Okay, and how to identify authentic certification organization?
Okay, so it is good. The link that I shared, again I can write that, apeda.gov.in. So on this link, one can go and see the approved, they have listed in Word document an approved certification body list. So imagine if someone comes to you that I am a green card, black card, you know, they come up with some name and they say, okay, I am a certification body. Then you can cross verify. Yes.
Okay.
Timeline.
How long does
I
it take
want
to
to
get?
learn about timeline here. How long does it take to get certified? Usually, this is a very good question, Mr. Steve, because perhaps I missed that during my presentation. As for timeline, when it comes to farmer, now let me confine my answer to farming part because you are interested in farming. So farming is, you know, for farmer, usually the certification process for that particular year is completed in 1 month. For example, you apply, then inspection happens, and then you we give you the certificate. That happens in 1 month. But there is something called conversion period.